outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Liars and these thieves, there's no one unwelcome here. And that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you. To the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who fail, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow.
Thou must save and thou. fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne, Rock of Ages, clap for me.
Please join me in the call to worship. Around the world, people gather to break bread and pour wine.
We gather with them in heart and mind.
Around the world, the broken body is made whole. Around the world, the banquet of God is prepared for the table.
We who share in the banquet come eagerly to be fed.
Let us worship together. Let us share God's bounty.
Would you join me in prayer? God, we thank you for this time and this place to honor you, to worship you, to bring you glory for our love within our hearts for you. In your Son's name, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Do we have birthdays or anniversaries? And I don't hear anybody jingling coins like last week. So Peggy did celebrate a birthday, I think it was yesterday. So it was either yesterday or Friday. So if you get a chance, maybe tell her happy birthday. And anyone else that you know of that isn't here or is just not owning up to it for a birthday or anniversary, we love you all and
it's
happy
morning
birthday
time.
Or anniversary. Let's come together for our joys and our concerns. If you were not here last week, you know that I have asked you to keep your prayers down to one or two sentences. So you have to be concise to one or two sentences. Now, I understand there are many of you that don't like that. There are also many of you that love that. I have heard from all. Okay, probably not all. So just one or two sentences. And also, I did not tell you last week, but if you feel like you can't keep it down to that, or you have a prayer that you want to share in private, there is the prayer box in the back that I do check. Okay? All right. Yes. Sorry, we're going to do Shannon and then Marilyn.
For God's best and that he meets their needs.
And your heart. That's what we will pray. And then Mary Lynn?
Yes, prayers for my grandson, Jacob. He's in South Carolina right now. And I sent him a message, how are you doing? Let me know. And he said, we're doing fine, Grandma, or hunker down.
Yeah.
And the wind is picking up. And that was a few days ago. So prayers for
Jacob, his family. And I'm going to tag on to that. Of anyone in the Carolinas, plus everyone in Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Florida that have just gotten, hammered. Yeah. So we lift them up in prayer, absolutely. Who else? Yes.
Joys for Mariah and the four of us that were able to go to Aspire last night. It was awesome.
It was last night.
Yeah. Oh. So I was able to take my mom, and then I have a friend that I've had since kindergarten who kind of had me going to church when I was a kid, and we've known each other for a really long time, so she was able to go with, too. So.
Prayers for renewal and refreshment that comes in surprising places. Yeah, absolutely.
We also have prayers for Bill. He sent a message in this morning saying he wants you guys to know how much he appreciates all of the prayer. He is still, of course, struggling. There are a lot of tests to be done, but he is not here today because he is supporting others in their cancer journey
as
well.
So for Bill, as well as all that are dealing with cancer,
and I think it's amazing that he is willing to support others in the same situation. So we lift him and others in prayer. Anyone else? Robin? Yeah, absolutely. So just so that you guys know, Gail came home a week ago, Friday, and so they are struggling with trying to make everything work and what they need, the equipment that they need, et cetera. So prayers for them, and thank you for bringing that up. And it's very difficult for all of them, I'm sure. So for those that are trying to figure out how to do the best for their families in the time of need, and I think that includes Michelle as well, by the way, trying to do the best for family in need. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes. Hi, Janine. Got it. So a joy for everything you do for God's creatures, and prayers for Barry's family. Absolutely. Anyone else? All right. Yes?
A prayer for my brother. He just called this morning and asked me what the symptoms of gallbladder problems are, and I'm pretty sure he has endless gallbladder problems.
Okay. For the wisdom of doctors and care providers. Yeah. Let us lift all of these prayers up to God. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this time and opportunity to lift our prayers up to you and to share them with each other. And God, you know all of the details of the prayers, and you know those that have not been said as well. And we thank you for the fact that you know our hearts and our desires and our love for people. So thank you, God, for caring for us so well. Now let us come together in the prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Could I have a couple of ushers as we continue to worship our Lord? Ushers, please come forward. Thank you both. Would you please stand as you're able for the doxology? We thank you for the love that we have for you, for the provision that you give us, that you bless us with, and that we have the faith to not only give of what we have, but to count us in your work. magnify our love for you to others in your Son's name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture reading comes from Psalm 51, 10 through 12. God, create a pure heart in me. Give me a new spirit that is faithful to you. Don't send me away from you. Don't take your Holy Spirit away from me. Give me back the joy that comes from being saved by you. Give me a spirit that obeys you so that I will keep going. These are the words of our Lord.
Praise be to God.
Timing. This is
good timing.
Yeah, this is what we all need right now.
Yeah. God's timing is perfect.
Yep.
Absolutely. So we are talking about what the Apostles' Creed means. I promise we will get back around to that scripture. And what I want you to do is figure out how the Apostles' Creed and the meaning works into the scripture that we just heard. I was asked to preach about the Apostles' Creed, in fact, all of what communion is about, quite a while back, and I thought the perfect place to start would be the Apostles' Creed, because you read it, or you repeat it, and you will do that again today, and you'll recognize the words. You may not, it doesn't say on your piece of paper or on the PowerPoint Apostles' Creed, but you will know it when you hear it. And basically what the Apostles' Creed is a very simple way of coming together as Christians, taking out all of the, but I believe this, or I believe that, or what about this, that very simple, we believe in God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit within. That's very simple. And this is World Communion Sunday, which is a good time to talk about the Apostles' Creed and what we believe. And I know that a lot of you already know what I'm going to say, and it doesn't hurt to hear it again. When I was preparing this sermon, I thought, man, I need to refresh myself over and over and over and remind myself about everything that God has done for us. Because the world tells us over and over and over about what the world does or does not do for us, right? So we need to remember and have God first and foremost. So we're going to explore the Apostles' Creed and prepare our hearts to take communion with so many around the world. So first, let's talk about the historical significance. The Apostles' Creed is the oldest and the simplest confessional creed that we have. Originally, because it's called the Apostles' Creed, there were people that thought that it was the 12 apostles that came up with it. And in fact, if you delve minutely into the creed, there are 12 different sections. It is not, the apostles did not come up with it. In fact, it actually is a modification from the old Roman creed back in the 4th century. So what happened in the 4th century, so we had something called the Edict of Milan. Edict, E-D-I-C-T, is another word for a law. So there was a law that was imposed, and finally, Christians could not be persecuted for their faith. That's the Edict of Milan. So Christians could openly practice their faith without fear of being persecuted or harmed. Now, what happens when people get together and they start gathering in reference to their faith and they explore what it means? What happens is then they go, well, what does it mean? And different people have different interpretations of what God the Father means, what Jesus Christ means, what the Holy Spirit means. And so back in the 4th century, the leaders of the Christian faith got together and said, we need to pound out in the simplest form what everybody can agree to. Now, I find this interesting because there is a lot that we don't agree on. That's why we have so many different Christian denominations. God the Father, Jesus the Son, Holy Spirit that lives within, we can all agree on that if we are Christ followers. That's what being a Christ follower means. So, and there are other more complicated creeds, but this is the one that we say because we don't want to offend anybody, and we certainly don't want somebody to say something that they don't believe in. Okay, does that make sense so far? Okay, so the creed was put together back in the 4th century, and then we have a place where what happens is it took a long time. All of these leaders, they got together and they said, okay, we know about God the Father, but what does it mean when we say God the Father? Who is God the Father? And then in the creed, you'll hear God the Father, and then you'll hear an explanation. And then the next part is Jesus the Son. Okay, we know about Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, but who is he and what did he do? Then the next part will fill in that gap. And then the Holy Spirit. Now, interestingly, I find it very interesting that there is really only one sentence about the Holy Spirit, which, if you have been here long enough, you understand that the Holy Spirit is really hard to grasp. So I kind of thought, well, thank you, leaders, because A, it makes me feel like I'm not so stupid after all. But B, on the other side is, wow, thank you, leaders. You were so helpful, the Holy Spirit. Kind of tongue-in-cheek on both sides. But it leaves it up to us to continue to ask questions. And the one thing that you should all know by now is God loves questions, because when we ask questions, we dig for the answers and we get stronger in our faith. And then the last part of the creed talks about the rest, talks about joining together and who the saints are and who the head of the church is. And so we have first God the Father, we have Jesus the Son, we have the Holy Spirit, and then we have everything else in that affirmation of faith. So that's where we're going. As far as our denomination is concerned, United Methodists, we believe that salvation is granted by God's grace and faith in Jesus. That's it. There is nothing else that is needed. When we believe that Jesus is Lord and Savior, that's it. We don't have to do anything else. Now, why do I and many other pastors stand up and preach about doing something? Because we are also called to, when we are obedient to God, the obedience propels us to tell other people about Jesus, okay? But if we don't tell a soul, as soon as we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and we say nothing for the rest of our lives, we will still go to heaven. We just will have to answer for why we haven't been as obedient as we should be. So the only thing we have to do, Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, we will go to heaven. Christ died on the cross for our sin, and this is sufficient for salvation and eternal life. Growing in God's understanding of all of that and everything else to come, excuse me. Head colds are so real, aren't they? I'm so sorry. Growing in the understanding of what salvation is and praising God for everything he does, for his prevenient grace, his justifying grace, his sanctifying grace, is what we are all about. It is what we spend the rest of our lives doing, understanding those terms. What is prevenient grace? What is justifying grace? What is sanctifying grace? And we're going to go over that just a little bit, but grace is grace. As Methodists, we derive from the father of Methodism, which is John Wesley. John Wesley had this really tough time when he was younger trying to figure out what he needed to do to come to being obedient with God, what he had to do because he felt like he wasn't worthy. And so what happened was he kind of talked about three different divisions of grace. And so we will get there in reference to prevenient, justifying, and sanctifying grace. But grace is grace. God's grace is something we will never understand as humans. I can say to somebody, I am giving you grace even though you hurt me. I am giving you grace even though I'm angry with you. I'm giving you grace. Or I can say that to myself in my mind, I am giving you grace. But I still don't understand the level of grace that God gives each one of us. His grace is based on his love, which knows no bounds. Speaking of no bounds, God is not bound by anything, by time, by space, by anything we do. God is God, all-powerful, almighty, not bound by anything. Our beliefs as Methodists are founded and grounded in Scripture. There is nothing we do that is outside of Scripture. So if you, what should happen if you are going to a Methodist church is when you are hearing the sermon, it is grounded in Scripture. And pastors take a, and I think that most pastors, regardless of the Christian denomination, if you're working from the Bible, you take great care to make sure that you are not saying Scripture watered down or inaccurate. You want to make sure that you present the Scripture as it is in the Bible. And you all are supposed to do the same thing when you're talking to people. So let us look at the words and the meaning. First, God the Father Almighty. The first thing that you will see when you look at the Apostles' Creed is, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You remember that, right? This is the beginning of the Apostles' Creed. So the one living, true God, present before time, the one that created time, the one that will end time, the one that is everywhere at the same time, the one who will outlast time. God is not bound by anything in this world. And so let's then talk about why we call God our Father. So God the Father sometimes can be difficult for people to hear. If they didn't have a very good father coming in their upbringing, they may not think of God the Father as somebody that they want to go to in prayer. But we want to remember that God is neither male or female. Okay, God is not bound by a gender. The pronoun he is adopted by Scripture. He chose to confine himself as man when Jesus Christ came to the earth. So we say God the Father, we say he. But this isn't a matter of a literal male entity. Okay, God is God, neither male nor female. So you might hear people say God every time rather than he. Rather, you certainly don't want to say it. So, but God as the creator, God as the protector, God as the almighty, rather than saying God the Father, we are all talking about the same God, okay? So God is of infinite power, wisdom, and goodness. He's the maker of everything in heaven and on earth. We proclaim this belief of three persons in one entity, one substance, one power, one eternity. So we have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but one substance, one entity all together. If we go further than that, eventually we go to a place where our heads hurt because we can't fit it all in our ability to understand, because we will not understand how it is that we get to call God the Father, we get to call Jesus the Christ and the Son of Man, the Son of God, we get to call Holy Spirit the one that lives within us, but now we have to figure out how they are all in one, especially when Scripture says Jesus Christ sits to the right of God the Father in heaven. And the Holy Spirit lives within. But remember what I said, God is not bound by time or place or space. So God is everywhere at the same time. Okay? Then we go to Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord. The Apostles' Creed says, I believe, and this is a big chunk, by the way, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and on the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. This creed tells us who and what, this part of the creed tells us who and what we believe in. By accepting Jesus as our Lord, we are saying that we believe Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. He is the Son of God, but also he is the Son of Man. He is the head of man as well. But more importantly, he's also God. He chose not to exercise being God while on earth. But that didn't make him any less God. Are you guys with me so far?
Okay, so Jesus the man was born to Mary through the interaction of the Holy Spirit. Again, God. Jesus grew up as a man with all the emotions and all the feelings of a person, because when we look at the life and times of Jesus, we want to know that we don't just say, oh, well, of course he got through this difficult time because he's God, so he didn't feel anything. No, Scripture specifically says Jesus went through everything that we go through, and he still was able to avoid the temptations of the enemy. Okay? So, If he was exercising the power of God through the suffering, then that would give us an out. God is saying you don't get an out. You get to be obedient under any circumstances, just like Jesus was obedient under any circumstances, even when he died on the cross. Jesus grew up as a man with everything that we grow up with, and his love for God and his obedience to the Father was without blemish. He suffered for being without blemish. He suffered for the obedience that he displayed. He suffered under the hands of Pontius Pilate, the one who knew he wasn't guilty, the one who wanted to let him go, but the one that fell into the human feelings of, if I let this man go, I will be the next one on the chopping block. And so I am going to do what the people want. How many times do we just go along with what people want? Because it's easier. We want to think that Pilate should not have gone along with what people want, but we do it all the time. And so Jesus, for his obedience, for his love for God, and for his love for humanity, suffered under a human's power. That would be Pontius Pilate. Pilate had the ability and power to set him free, but chose not to. And in Pilate's brokenness and sin, he set the wheels in motion that brought about the death of this man and this God, Jesus the Christ. This man was put to death. This God was not, because you cannot put to death God. Jesus, Son of God, did not die. Jesus, Son of Man, died. We believe Jesus as a man hung on the cross and died there, and he was taken down and he was buried. He was not seen again until 3 days later, and when he arose from the dead. And then he spent 40 days on earth teaching and preaching and showing people how they can spread the good news of who he is. And then he rose into heaven, where he is seated at the right hand of God the Father. Jesus will judge all of us, living and dead, eventually. We don't know when that is. I don't know about you, but I would love to know when Jesus is going to come back, because then I'll start being good. We have no idea when Jesus will judge us as well as the dead, but he will. And as Christians, we believe that it is through his blood, his saving blood, shed on the cross, that we ourselves are saved. We do not go to heaven or have relationship with God for anything because of anything that we do. It is impossible. We go not because we're worthy, but we go because Christ made us valuable in God's eyes. And then we believe in the saving grace of God, because we are nothing. And we are broken, and we are sin-filled. But Jesus takes all of those sins, and then we can have a relationship with the grace-filled God. So God is not this vindictive, mean-spirited God. God wants to give us all the opportunity to come to him. He doesn't want to lose even one. So God's love is such that he wants us to be with him. John Wesley then came up with, as I said, prevenient grace, justifying grace, and sanctifying grace. So prevenient grace. Prevenient, the word prevenient, pre, P-R-E. What does that mean? Before.
So before we know who God is in our lives, whatever age we are, before we are capable of knowing who God is, God extends his grace to us. In other words, we still get to go to heaven even though we have not had the opportunity to know who God is. Who decides whether or not you have the opportunity to know God? God. But in his prevenient grace, he says, I want not one to be lost. And then there is a point in time in our lives where we have this moment where we go, oh, there is a God. Now, we may not act on it, but we have this moment where we go, there is a God. At that point, everything shifts, and you are responsible for, we all are responsible for learning who God is. And there is this moment when we learn who God is, we know who he is, we know who Jesus is. By the way, knowing doesn't mean knowing everything. You don't wait until you know everything about God and Christ and the Holy Spirit to ask him to come into your life, because otherwise you will be dead. In other words, we don't know. We spend our whole lives trying to figure it out. But when you believe, that is different than knowing. When you believe that God is the Father and Jesus came to earth as man, died on the cross, shedding his blood, he is the Lord and he is the Savior, you then can ask him, Jesus, to come into your life. The moment that you do that, Jesus Christ, come into my life, the moment that you do that, you are in justifying grace. Justifying grace, think about it as just as if you have never sinned. When you take Christ into your life and you welcome him into your heart, it is just as if you have not sinned. Past, present, future sins. Now, justifying grace only lasts just a few minutes, because when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we then go into the sanctifying grace. Sanctifying, by the way, sanctification means set aside. So when you hear sanctification, it is set aside for a holy purpose. You, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you are set aside for his holy purpose. You do his will based on what he does within you and that holy purpose that he has within you. That's when the Holy Spirit lives within you to help you to do everything God wants. Now, I understand this is very complicated, so I understand all of the blank stares I'm getting. I want to put it into an analogy. Picture a house out in the woods. It has one of those front porches. There is no back door. It has a front porch. The only way in that house is the front door. There is wilderness all around it. There might even be a nice path going up to the porch. But the only way to get in that house is by going up on the front porch. When you are wandering around the house on the beautiful grounds, you are in prevenient grace. You have no idea what's in that house. You're wandering around not knowing what God can do for you or the blessings that you get by knowing who he is. You're wandering in the wilderness. Okay. At some point, you make a decision that you're going to go up the stairs and knock on that door. The only way that you're making a decision to go in the house, but the only way that you can get in the house is going up the stairs on the porch and knocking on the door. The porch is the justifying grace. You make a decision to be up on the porch. You make a decision to welcome Christ into your life. You are standing on the porch, but you knock on the door, and as soon as you go through the threshold of that door, you are in the land of sanctifying grace. And that is where you spend the rest of your life, getting to know who God is. Okay? Now, grace is grace. You don't lose the justifying grace. You gain the sanctification of being set aside. But you are all forgiven for your sins, whatever they may be. All you do is ask with a repentant heart. So let's talk about that. For us, when we come to God and we ask for forgiveness. God forgives everything. But we come asking for forgiveness with purity in our hearts, not just because we feel like we have to ask for forgiveness. In other words, I can ask for forgiveness for something, but if I'm not really sorry and don't intend to do it again, God knows my heart. There's really no point in speaking the words because God knows my heart. But when we ask for forgiveness for whatever it is that we have done, and there is a list a mile long for me today, and the day just started. When we ask over and over and over for forgiveness for sin, what God does is he forgives immediately, as long as we have the repentant heart. Repentance means we are going to try as hard as we can to stop doing what it is that is causing the sin and turn around, go away from the sin, and come back to God. That's the repentant heart. There are times in our lives that we don't feel worthy. There are times in our lives that we feel unloved by others. There are times in our lives that we don't love ourselves. There are times that we believe that we cannot recover from our worldly mistakes. But the fact is that when God is living within you, you are worthy. God gives you value, which is the next spot I want to talk about, the Holy Spirit. Because the Apostles' Creed says, I believe in the Holy Spirit. God doesn't just live in the heavens, removed from his children. God doesn't just live on earth as Christ and then poof, he leaves us to defend ourselves. God remains with us, living in us to help us, to give us wisdom. And God within us is who gives us godly value. Even when you feel like you are not worthy, God says, I live within you, and because I live within you, you have godly value. Even when the world is telling you that you are nothing, God says that is a lie from Satan because you are worthy and of value as I deem and determine you are valued, not as the world determines. The Spirit gives us courage to speak God's words. Have you ever said something to somebody that is struggling and you talk with them about God and you go, where did that come from? Because there's no way I knew those words a second ago. That is the Holy Spirit within you. We don't know the words exist until the Holy Spirit gives us the words. So when we are with somebody, the first thing we do is, God, can you speak for me? Reduce my voice, up the volume on your voice, and I will be faithful in talking about you. The Spirit is always working within us, teaching us, loving on us, giving us courage, even when we don't realize it. The Holy Spirit right now is working within you. You may not realize it. You may be wondering how long it's going to take before I get through this whole Apostles' Creed and wondering why it is that it is so stinking long that we have to go through it today. And the Holy Spirit is still working within you, molding you, talking with you, giving you the understanding of why it's important. The Spirit gives us the courage, gives us hope when we feel hopeless. He is our lifeline when we feel like giving up. He's our everything who leads us in the direction of righteousness. We may choose to ignore the Holy Spirit and get off track, but it doesn't mean he's not talking with us. Think about when you have a conversation with somebody, you can be going like this, yep. And about 10 minutes later, you go, wait, what did they say? We do that sometimes to the Holy Spirit, but that doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit is not talking, just like it doesn't mean the person that you happen to not listen to, but is standing there talking, that they're still talking. You just missed the point. The rest of the beliefs are this. I believe in the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. All right, so this gets us down to the reaffirmation of our belief in the Church of Christ. This is, when we talk about it, we say the Holy Universal Church. Now, you may have heard the Apostles' Creed saying the Holy Catholic Church, it is the same thing. In Greek, Catholic is derived from a Greek adjective meaning katholikos, and it means universal or the whole. What happened is there are some denominations, Methodists included, that we don't want to confuse you when we say the Holy Catholic Church, because we might think Catholic meaning the Catholic Church, not the whole or the universal meaning that comes from the Greek adjective. So we just try to not hurt our brains too much and put universal, which means the whole. The global church, everyone who believes Christ is Lord, is under that whole universal church. This is where God reigns. This is where Christ reigns. This is where Christ is at the center. This is the place where we believe that all Christians are brothers and sisters joined together because we believe in God the Father and Jesus the Son, and we inherit the same as Jesus did. As followers of Christ, you are saints. Do you realize that? As followers of Christ, you are saints. We come together spiritually as one family. Spiritually as one family, God makes you saints. It is the communion of saints, the communion of all brothers and sisters who believe in Christ coming together. That is the communion, the gathering together of all who believe in Christ. And then when we believe that we sin, and we do often, we also understand that we will be forgiven as soon as we ask with repentant heart for forgiveness. That is why it says we believe in the forgiveness of sins. This is the meaning of coming to God with a repentant heart, as I have already mentioned. And we believe that Christ rose from the dead, that he's in heaven. He didn't just stay on earth, he ascended. And when it talks about that in Scripture, we believe that's exactly what happened, and he is seated at the right hand of God the Father. We understand when we believe that, that God did this for Jesus the Christ, and he will do it for us as well. We will rise when our time on earth is over. Okay, that's the whole Apostles' Creed. Take a deep breath. Is your mind just blown? And when you say it from now on, you can remember a little bit more, or go look deeper, dig deeper. Don't just take my word for it. Dig deeper. There's a meaning to what we say. But what is the relevance for us? Ah, that's where Psalm 51 comes in. Listen to what Teresa read again, verses 10 through 12. God, create a pure heart in me. Give me a new spirit that is faithful to you. Don't send me away from you. Don't take your Holy Spirit away from me. Give me back the joy that comes from being saved by you. Give me a spirit that obeys you so that I will keep going. This is a prayer from David. Please, God, don't go away from us. What is the relevance? Why do we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed? For the same reason that David wrote the Psalm 51, because we are broken and we are in the need of the faith and love and belief that God provides. David wrote this Psalm, by the way, when he had committed adultery and had committed murder. He knew that he was as far away from God as he could possibly be at that moment, and he wanted to come back into God's good graces. He wanted not to cover up sin with more sin. He wanted to repent and know that God was still with him. We do the same thing, by the way. Okay, I know that we probably don't commit sins to the same depth that David did as far as adultery or murder, but God considers all sin to be equal. So if you lie, if you gossip, if you wish in your mind somebody ill will, you have created sin. You have not just created it, you have sinned. And when you sin, God says it is equal, the same in God's eyes as murder or adultery. We need the prayer that David wrote in Psalm 51. We come to God knowing our brokenness, asking God to create purity in our hearts. I don't know about you, but there are times that I feel so far away from a pure heart, it scares me. And I feel so far away from God, it concerns me. And thank you, God, with your grace, that all I have to do is turn back and say, just cleanse me, mold me, make me into what you want. I stand before you broken. And I come to you because I can't stand to be away from you any longer, because I know what I've done is wrong. It's what David did. We know our brokenness. We ask God to step in. We affirm our faith, reminding ourselves that Christ gave everything. He gave everything not because we're perfect. He gave everything because he knows our imperfections. And we can find joy in our salvation. You may not remember the prevenient grace, the justifying grace. You may not remember that, but what you remember is God has grace for you. Otherwise, he would not have sent Christ to save you. We enjoy our salvation, and we don't let anyone steal that joy. We come to the table today, and every time we come to communion, renewing our faith, to remember everything that Jesus did for us, to accept the grace of God so that we can try to live into the freedom that he gave us. Sin has no power over us. Sin is powerless unless you allow it to have power over your life. We are forgiven by God's grace. Amen. Let us come together and prepare our hearts with our communion song.
The exalted Lord! Exalted Lord!
There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Your mercy flows like a river wide, and healing comes from your hand. Suffering children are safe in your arms. There is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I can say
But those of you who desire to lead a life worthy of Jesus Christ, renew your covenant with God. Do you trust in God with all your heart, mind, and strength?
I do.
Will you trust the Holy Spirit to guide your life from this moment forth?
I will.
Will you put Jesus first in your life, trusting nothing else for your salvation?
I will.
Do you reject the bondage of sin, and are you determined to live in the liberty God gives us?
I do.
Are you willing to give an account for the hope which dwells inside you to anyone who asks?
I am, God being my helper.
Are you resolved to serve God, that others might know his love?
I am, by God's grace.
Will you strive from this moment to refrain from any attitudes or practices which cheapen the love of God as revealed in Jesus Christ?
I will, God being my strength and helper.
Affirmation of faith. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Christ gave everything for us. In Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, there isn't anything God doesn't do for us. Sometimes, I know I'm guilty of it, sometimes we go about our day and we don't remember the relevance of Jesus. Sometimes we come to the altar not taking the moment to remember everything that Christ did on this Communion Sunday. Take a moment. Be at the altar as long as you want. Teresa and I will stay over here, and we will not bother you. And I ask that as people are coming up, give them space. So if there's people at the altar, just hang out and wait. It is time to be with your Lord. He has died to be with you. Teresa?
Invitation. Christ our Lord invites you to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Confession and pardon. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. You have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love, and we have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The prayer of consecration. Lord, we do not come to your table trusting in our own righteousness, but in your many and varied mercies. We are not worthy even to gather up crumbs under your table, but your nature has never changed. You have always been gracious and merciful. Therefore, enable us to truly participate in this sacrament of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may walk in the newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
On the night that Christ was betrayed, knowing that he would die for all of us, all the people before us, and all the people after us. He took the bread, and with those right in front of him, and with almost an understanding, in fact, I'm sure not almost, an understanding that those that were before him represented those to come as well, he took it and he prayed to God the Father, knowing everything that was going to happen. He still gave thanks to God for what was to come. We often talk about giving thanks in the good and the bad. Jesus leads us through that, giving thanks for the, in his mind, the good as God, the bad as human. He lifted it up and he prayed to the Father. God Almighty, King of the universe, creator of all things, creator of the bread and the fruit of the vine, God, we give you thanks for all things, good and bad. We give you thanks for everything we don't even know is to happen, or the things that you save us from that we are just oblivious from. God, we thank you for your provision, your love, your grace, your mercy. In your Son's name, amen. And then he took the bread after giving thanks. And he said, this is my body broken for you and for the many. And then after the meal, he took the cup and he said, this is my blood shed for you and the many. And every time you take of this bread and you drink of this cup, you do this in remembrance of me until I come again. We are part of a universal, whole church globally. Let us come together and worship our Lord in our holy sacrament of communion. So we're going to start with the front and go ahead and come forth.
Thank you.
whatever happens this week, whether you know right now what's going to happen or whether you're oblivious to the things of this week, remember that God lives within you. God defines your value, not the things that happen this week, not the things of this world, not the hurtful things that broken people say, because we are all broken and we will all say hurtful things. God, in his perfect love, loves you, resides in you. Amen. God loves you that much.